Thank you very much, Frank, for this nice introduction. Thanks a lot for the invitation. Today I'd like to give you an update on the pachychoroid disease spectrum. Well, where actually does the term pachychoroid come from? You all know, pachychoroid means thick choroid. Since 2004, we know that in central serous choroidopathy in PCV is correlated to a thick choroid. However, the term pachychoroid was first mentioned in 2013 when David Warrow and colleagues have been describing pathologic changes of the RPE, CNV, and polyps in relation to a thickened choroid. And linked to this, they gave the name pachychoroid, the thickened choroid. Since then, the number of publications has increased dramatically. Just checked yesterday, 377. So the question is, why is this new entity so successful? Is it just a simple idea that we have a second pathomechanism leading to changes of the RP, choroid, and retina, similar to the AMD, but with a primarily dysfunction of the choroid? Well, nowadays we have to distinguish between atrophic versus pachychoroid maculopathies. With a thin choroid is associated and present in intermediate AMD and geographic atrophy, and a thick choroid is associated with the pachychoroid disease spectrum. So this simple classification into two groups improves the understanding of macular disease, thereby solving many diagnostic puzzles. Is pachychoroid its own entity? It might be. Investigations have shown that the concentration of VEGF is much lower in PNV in contrast to AMD. So it might be that this is it, that those two are its own entities. The spectrum of pachychoroid maculopathies covers four diseases. It's the central serous choroidopathy. Typically, patients or fellow eyes have also RPE changes. We find CNVs, MNVs actually, typically in more younger patients, and we know that we have PCVs with a thick choroid. So all these diseases are linked to the pachychoroid phenotype. However, probably there are not four diseases by themselves, but four stages of one disease. To better illustrate this relationship, we have proposed the following classification. Stage 1, pachychoroid pigment epitheliopathy. Stage 2, central serous choroidopathy. Stage 3, pachychoroid neovasculopathy. And stage 4, PCV, pachychoroid choroidal vasculopathy. Due to the hyperpermeability of the choroid, fluid is drained, and the drained fluid presses against the RPE and leading to erosions of the RPE. We can see this in fluorescein angiography, this hyperreflective spots. In ICG angiography, you can see the choroidal hyperpermeability. We have a hyperreflective activated RP on the one hand, on the other hand, also hypometabolic, hyporeflective RP in the autofluorescence. All these features appear with the first stage, the pachychoroid pigment epitheliopathy. And if the disease advances, if the RP damage gets more and more, we even get rips, and then subretinal fluid occurs. And then we have the second stage, which is the central serous choroidopathy. In 25 to 30% of the patients, MNV develops, and we don't call this MNV CSC with TV, but we call it pachychoroid neovasculopathy, which on the one hand can be seen with or without subretinal fluid. And the end stage is filiformis totus, probably is the PCV, the polypolar vasculopathy, when the immature vessels develop aneurysms and we have a leakage of the vessel and a drainage in the subretinal, intraretinal, and sub-RP space. So the big question is, can this theory be packed up with facts? In other words, has progression among these stages of the disease been documented? Let's start with the transition conversion of pachychoroid pigment epitheliopathy to CSCRC. Well, let's go back to the case of before, just presented. Here you can see the changes of the pachychoroid pigmented epithelial prothesis when the patient presented first. He came back 1 year later and subretinal fluid was here. So it looks like there is a transition, and we meanwhile know that 61 to 90% of the patients with dental serous retinopathy have RP changes in the partner eye, and about 17% of patients with pachychoroid pigmented epithelial prothesis develop central serous choroidopathy within 6 years. What can be done? What's the management in this case as well? Maybe, unfortunately, more or less simply observe. However, we can try to avoid corticosteroid therapy and probably reduce stress. Once central serous choroidopathy is present and there's no spontaneous regression in the first 3 months, we have learned that half-dose PDD is very successful in positive influencing the disease. We know that half-dose PDT is superior to the subthreshold micropulse laser treatment, and that mineral corticosteroid antagonists are worse compared to the half-dose PDT. Now let's go to the next step, central serous choroidopathy to transition to PNV. Again, a case of our clinic, 2010, visual acuity 20/40, patient came back 8 years later, visual acuity decreased, 20/160, OCTA revealed CNV, a PNV, he got 2 injections of anti-VEGF, and improvement was here, we could observe an improvement, visual acuity 20/50, and a shallow irregular PED remained. So meanwhile, we know that we have about 25% to 95% transition from central serous choroidopathy to PNV. What can we do in this stage? Well, treatment, of course, first step anti-VEGF, and in treatment refractory diseases, PDD is the treatment of choice. Last step, PNV, transition to aneurysmal type 1 CNV or polypoidal choroidal vasculopathy. Actually, already in 2015, Peng and colleagues postulated that there is a that PNV can ultimately process to the development of PCV. In order to investigate how often this actually happens, we made a database research with our smart eye data. We were looking for eyes diagnosed for PNV with a minimal follow-up of 2 years. 49 patients have been included, have been found. We had to exclude 12 patients due to misdiagnosis and shorter follow-up. However, in the end, 37% were excluded with a full model, multi-model imaging. Mean age of the patients was 60, mean follow-up 3.2 years, and the subfoveal thickness was about 360. And did we see progression? Indeed, we saw them. It were 5 patients with a new onset of PCV. Here is a case, PPE at the very beginning, then he developed PNV. He got altogether 9 anti-VEGF injections with a perfect recovery. However, a few months later, he came back and presenting a typical aneurysmal type 1 CNV with a typical peaking PED. And, of course, the first in angiography, the ACG angiography, we saw the polyps lesions. So, if we now explorate the risk of conversion based on our data, we see a progression to aneurysmal type 1 CNV in 7.4% after 3 years, 13% after 4 years, and 30% after 5 years. So, now what to do in this case? Of course, anti-VEGF and full dose PDD is the treatment of choice in this situation. Now, why is the choroid so abnormally thickened? Well, Matsumoto and colleagues in 2019 with en face OCT showed that the drainage of healthy choroid respect the horizontal watershed. That means that the superior part drains superior, the other drains inferior. It was shown that 80% of healthy eyes respect the watershed, and in contrast, 90% of patients with the PNV do not respect this watershed. We see anastomosis crossing the horizontal border. And secondly, the second abnormality is the asymmetry, which we see in the vertical veins. In 62% of patients of healthy eyes, there are symmetric vortex veins, in contrast to 100% of CSCRS patients showing an asymmetric vortex veins. And if you go from the center to the periphery, it can even see better. We see a symmetry of the vortex veins in healthy eyes and an asymmetry in patients with central cerebral retinopathy. As you can see here, this prominent superiotemporal vortex vein indicating that this vein is not working sufficiently. And what is the consequence of these congestions? We can see it here, it's beautifully demonstrated by Kish and colleagues. We have here this dilated vortex vein. This leads to a hollow vein congestion and, you know, furthermore, to a reduced blood flow, ischemia of the corocapillaris, which can be indicated by a delayed filling in the OCTA. You see these black spots here. And due to this congestion, as the congestion seems to be the major pathophysiologic factor, Spade and colleagues recommended to rename this disease in venous overload choroidopathy in order to anchor the Packer definition in the name. Now the question is, why are the vortex veins compressed? Well, the actual idea is that it's the rigid sclera which compresses the vortex veins, similar to patients having ural effusion syndrome. They also have a thick sclera, and both of these diseases more often appear in patients with hyperopia. It meanwhile has been proven that central cerebral retinopathy patients have a thicker choroid and that there's a relationship between the choroidal thickness and the scleral thickness. Another probably pathomechanism which might play a role is that we have an angled cord through the sclera similar to the self-sealing incisions in the vitrectomy, and this also compresses the veins. So in summary, for the pathomechanisms, we have a Packer sclera with a high rigidity of the sclera. This leads to a compression of the vortex vein, congestion, and then to the pathophysiologic changes. And to prove this theory, colleagues have shown this in the animal model. They sutured vortex veins in mice and rabbits and could prove that after 1 week, you can see the congestion, that the dilated vortex veins and the OCT, a thickening of the OCT hollow veins, and immunohistochemistry even revealed the damage of the retinal pigment epithelium, mimicking the pachychoroid pigment epitheliopathy. So still the question remains, how can we improve the outflow? Maybe in future it's going to be a creative surgery. Well, we don't know. But till then, I believe we should focus on the questions which are relevant for today, which we can already answer today. And this is, how can we now recognize pachychoroid? If you're sitting in front of a patient, ask yourself, is the choroid thick enough? Then the criteria for the diagnosis of pachychoroid is, first, choroid thickness should be more than 300 micrometer. Secondly, the hollow veins, the diameter should be more than 180 micrometer. Third, have a look at the DFLA and ICG angiography. You will see the choroidal hyperpermeability in the ICG. And fourth factor, which plays a role, I just showed you before, the flow deficits in the corocapillaris, these black dots in the OCTA. And if you still don't know whether it's AMD or pachychoroid, have a look at the partner eye. And you will see that if you distinguish that these, though, if you look at this both, you can distinguish between AMD, macular neovascularization type 1, and pachychoroid CMV, because we will not find. Drusen in the partner eye of patients with pachychoroid. So, in conclusion, the pachychoroid phenotype is defined by choroidal congestion. PPE, pachychoroid pigment epitheliopathy, can progress to central cerebral retinopathy, and central cerebral retinopathy can process to PNV. And PNV again can develop aneurysms, defining the conversion to the so-called aneurysm type 1 CNV, or the polypoidal choroidal vasculopathy. We've shown that in 5 years we have to expect 31% of patients with this transition. The pachychoroid disease spectrum represents a logical continuum, and while we cannot treat the underlying cause right at the moment, which is the asymmetric vortex vein drainage, we can treat its complications just with PDT, half-dose PDT, and anti-VGF. Thank you very much for your kind invitation again, and for your